I agree with J.R. Bob Dobbs about that. Praise Bob. J.R. Bob Dobbs, the founder and chief executive officer of the Church of the Subgenius, he says the two most common errors in America are the belief that the politicians are dumb and that they mean well. I don't think they're dumb at all, and I certainly don't think they mean well. But they want us to be as dumb as possible. That's what I believe. I don't believe it currently or dogmatically, but that's my best guess. It's been done not only by Muhammad the Great and by the English and Iran, it's been done by all sorts of conquering groups. Hell, you don't want the people you conquer to be too smart, and you certainly don't want them armed. I love the word terrorism. Terrorism means we've disarmed them to the extent that the only way they can fight back is by blowing themselves up in the process. Oh, how horrible they must be to do something so stupid. Well, when you conquered people and you've taken their land away and you've mistreated them every way you can think of and taken away all the weapons they can possibly use, of course they're going to use whatever is left, and you can call them terrorists. They call the IRA terrorists, too. My God, England terrorized the world for 7 centuries or more, and they dare to call somebody else a terrorist? The United States has been bombing the world and blasting it all through my lifetime, and they dare to say anybody who strikes back is a terrorist? I don't think they lost all these messages warning about what was coming on 9/11. They just ignored them because they wanted an excuse for a war. The best war of all, an undefined war, a war defined so that it has no possible ending. A war against terrorism is like the Catholic Church's war against heresy. You never run out of heretics. Anybody can be accused of being a heretic, anybody who thinks for him, and anybody who resists in any way. Suppose we had another Gandhi, and he became a real pain in the ass to the bankers and corporation heads. You think they're going to tell us we got another Gandhi over here, we want to go kill him? No, they're going to say he's a terrorist, and they'll plant all sorts of evidence. I mean, they got an open invitation now. They've given themselves permission to attack any country in the world they want to just by yelling, more terrorists there, more terrorists over there. And we're not supposed to inquire into it. If we inquire into it, that's despicable thinking, according to Cheney. We're supposed to believe what they tell us.
Have you found it difficult at times to sustain your optimism since 9/11?
Strangely enough, no. 9/11 did not shock me the way it shocked most Americans. On CNN, they keep talking about 9/11 as the day the world changed. Well, the world didn't change. The world has been this way since the development of modern munitions by Nobel. People on this planet have been blowing up other people for 100 years now and doing it on a bigger and bigger scale every decade. The world didn't change. It's just it finally came back to America. In the last 50 years, America has been doing most of the bombing and nothing has been coming back and hitting us. I knew eventually something had to come back and hit the United States. It didn't surprise me at all when it happened. I just wondered why it took so long. So it didn't dampen my optimism. It just made me realize the struggle is going to be longer and harder than I realized. But then again, this may be the beginning of the end. Well, there's a commercial on television now that says change occurs on the edge of chaos. Those damn bastards will lift anything. That comes from Prigogine's Nobel Prize work in the 1970s on dissipative structures, which was a chemical thing, but he immediately saw the application of his mathematics to other complex systems, and he suggested the planet today is a dissipative structure. And since the 70s, it has been going through all the characteristic behaviors of a dissipative structure about to break down and reform on a higher level of coherence. And I think Internet provides the higher level of coherence, and all we got to do is get the governments out of the way and let the people of the world deal with each other over Internet. It'll take a while. It sounds utopian, but governments are a damn nuisance to everybody. Nobody really likes them. They only like their government better than other governments because they're brainwashed into thinking our government isn't quite as bad as the others. Everybody on the planet thinks that. The people in Singapore, which is probably the most dictatorial fascist-type state on the whole, but they probably think, well, it's not as bad as other governments.
When did you begin to sense that the U.S. government might be as bad as it is good?
Well, in the course of my disillusion, of course, like all Americans, I went through a school which trained me in patriotism. All advanced countries have schools where you're trained in patriotism. And I grew up believing all that. I don't know, I think I first started to have my doubts in high school. When the teachers, I had a bunch of liberal teachers in high school. New Deal liberals left over. This was the late 40s. They all told me that anybody who questioned the official version of Pearl Harbor was despicable. And some of them actually named historians who I shouldn't read because they were despicable. And this always brings out the skeptic in me, so I started reading the despicable historians, Harry Elmer Barnes, Charles Beard, James J. Martin, and they sort of keyed in with what I was reading of anarchist thought at that time. And I began to decide that Roosevelt set us up, just the way I think Bush set us up for the current attacks. And I wasn't really sure of that, and I'm not 100% sure of it even yet. I think it's a damn good bet. They were decoding for the Japanese codes, and they knew pretty much what the Japanese were planning. The Army Border, the Army Navy Joint Border Inquiry into Pearl Harbor concluded that from the decoded messages it was possible to deduce not only that an attack was coming, but where and the exact date and even the hour. Then came the Cold War, which happened too fast for me. I was listening to the radio and going to movies and all through World War II, and the Russians were our allies and the Germans were the villains. All the Germans were equally villainous. And then suddenly the Germans were our allies and the Russians were the villains, and all the Russians were equally villainous and all the Germans were equally heroic. There had never been a Nazi in Germany. It was an invasion of Eskimos that made up the Nazi Party. Not a single German was involved. I just couldn't believe it. It was too big a change. And then with Vietnam, I got more and more doubtful. And with the assassination of John F. Kennedy, I began to feel, my God, this is just like Europe in the Dark Ages. Things really haven't changed. It's like the Roman Empire. And more, decade by decade, I see more and more parallels, not only with the Roman Empire, but with the Tsarist epoch in Russia.
Are there any particular political parties or political philosophies that you support?
Well, I sometimes call myself a libertarian, but that's only because most people don't know what anarchist means. Most people think if you say you're an anarchist, it means you're getting ready to throw a bomb at a building. They don't understand the concept of voluntary association or the whole concept of replacing force with voluntary cooperation, contractual arrangements, and so on. So libertarian is a clearer word. It doesn't arouse so much immediate anxiety on the part of the listener. And then again, libertarians, if they were totally consistent with their principles, would be anarchists. They take the position which they call minarchy, which is the smallest possible government. That's a very Jeffersonian idea. The reason I don't believe in the smallest possible government is because we started out with that, and it only took us 200 years to arrive at the Tsarist occupation government that we got now. I think any government is dangerous, no matter how small you make it. It should be. Instead of governments, we should have contractual associations, which you can opt out of if you don't like the way the association is going. Like religions fought for hundreds of years over which religion should dominate Europe, and then they finally gave up and made a truce. And they all agree to tolerate one another, at least in this part of the world. Well, Americans aren't so sure about tolerating Islam right now, are they? But by and large, I think government should be treated like religion. Everybody should pick the kind they like. Only it should be contractual, not obligatory. I wouldn't mind paying tax money to a local association to maintain a police force, as long as we need one. But I hate like hell paying taxes to help the United States government build more nuclear missiles to blow up more people. I don't even know, but I don't think I would hate them if I did know them. A lot of anarchists had a major role in influencing my political thinking, especially the individualist anarchists, and Benjamin Tucker and Lysander Spooner especially. But I've also been influenced by Leo Tolstoy's anarcho-pacifism. And I find a lot of Kropotkin quite compatible, too, even though he was a communist anarchist. Nothing wrong with communist anarchism as long as it remains voluntary. Anybody wants to join together and make a commune, go ahead, do it. I got nothing against it. As long as there's room for the individualist, too, to do his own thing or her own thing, as the case may be, or its own thing. I'm in favor of freedom for dogs, too.
Are you encouraged by the current anti-corporate globalization movement?
Well, it's growing all the time, the anti-corporate movement. I don't like the term anti-globalization. I think globalization is inevitable. I don't like corporate globalization. I think the more power is centralized, the more dangerous it becomes. But I think decentralized globalization seems to me necessary if we're going to use the resources of the planet and beyond the planet most intelligently. Just restricting ourselves to the planet for a minute, the 92 chemical elements are scattered around at random. To get the maximum use out of them, we need some form of cooperation, which can either be achieved by conquest, by one power dominating all the rest of the world, like the United States is doing now and England was doing up until 1945. Or, if we can't stand any more wars, if they get too omni-lethal and threaten to destroy the whole human race, we'll eventually have to try the alternative, which is rational contract and cooperation, making deals that are to the benefit of both parties, so it's worthwhile. So you don't even have to enforce them. Everybody wants to live up to them. That's one of the basic things in Benjamin Tucker's theory of anarchism. A good contract should be drawn so that it doesn't need enforcement. It's so obviously to the benefit of all parties. I think the human race collectively has enough intelligence to produce such contracts. Once they get over the idea the only way to get what you want is to shoot the people who have it right now and take it from their dead bodies. I wish they would stop talking against globalization and talk against corporatization or something, or use some other word, because we're either going to have trade or we're going to have wars, or we're going to have both. I would prefer to have trade.
Well, since 9/11, war seems to be the route that much of the world is taking. Are you discouraged by this?
Well, in the short run, anybody who isn't pessimistic is has got to be stoned out of their gourd, I think. As long as the United States has these foreign policies that irritate three-quarters of the planet, we're going to have terrorists. We get rid of, somehow or other, the United States succeeds in getting rid of Osama bin Laden, and somehow or other manages to wipe out Al-Qaeda entirely and cripples Islam in some way that it's not going to give birth to another Al-Qaeda, all of which seems very improbable to you. But if they accomplish all that, as Bush says, this war has no end, because there'll be terrorists from other third world countries who'll be pissed off at us still. Until the United States gives up trying to bully the whole world, there's going to be terrorists trying to get out from under being bullied. So there's no end to this war. It's like the war on drugs, you know, no end in sight. The funding goes on forever, and the party never ends. The funding goes on forever and the party never ends. That's a paraphrase of a country and western song. I think my writing comes out of anger and optimism. Anger at the stupid, maniacal, or corrupt crowd that's running the world at present, and optimistic about the opportunities that are so real. Why don't science and technology create a real possibility of what used to be called utopia? Any utopian fantasy anybody ever imagined, we are on the edge of achieving it if we use our energy and our technology intelligently.